Mosquitoes are the most deadly animal on Earth, spreading diseases like malaria, dengue, West Nile, and more. As the world warms, we know the human climate niche changes, but so does theirs, meaning they can live and infect humans in more and more places. But in the US, they aren't the most dangerous or creepy. There are dozens of pathogens that are spreading and thriving in new locations, including some very new, very scary infections that are gaining ground across North America. But which are actually worth worrying about? And what can we do to stay safe? Well, in this episode, we teamed up with MD Alok Patel from PBS Vitals to help figure it out. We'll dig into the epidemiological data to show you exactly where major threats are spreading. And we'll save the creepiest for last, as well as what you can do to stay safe outside.
Changing weather patterns does affect the incidence of this infection. And one main concern in the recent years is that not only are we seeing an increasing number, we're also seeing increasing number of severe cases.
First, mosquitoes, because the numbers are staggering. In 2021 alone, malaria infected 247 million, resulting in 619,000 deaths globally, mostly in sub-Saharan Africa. And dengue fever, although less deadly, still kills over 20,000 each year and infects between 100 and 400 million. And the WHO estimates that about half of the world's population is now at risk. And get this, mosquito-borne illnesses are actually estimated to have killed nearly half of all the humans who have ever lived. We have very effective symptomatic treatment for malaria and dengue today, with most deaths from mosquito-borne illnesses occurring when treatment isn't available. But that wasn't the case 80 years ago. Malaria was such a big problem in the US that in 1946, the federal government decided to step in by creating the CDC, which began to eradicate mosquitoes by spraying the nerve poison DDT on, well, pretty much everything. But surprise, surprise, it turned out that DDT didn't only hurt insects, but animals and people too. So it was banned in the US, but not before malaria was declared eradicated here in 1951. So why are we talking about mosquito-borne disease now?
What's going to happen with climate change is that, as well as warming and changes in rainfall patterns, we're going to see a lot of climate variability on a sort of multi-month and multi-year scales. And this kind of variability, we've hypothesized, will drive the mosquito-borne diseases to be more epidemic.
So in other words, more big periodic outbreaks. Also, many mosquitoes have developed resistance to DDT. So we asked Dr. Patel about the leading cause of mosquito-borne disease in the US, West Nile virus.
Now here's something creepy. I can't actually tell you how many cases of West Nile virus I may have seen or come in contact with, because a lot of people, in fact, according to the CDC, somewhere around 80% of people who get West Nile virus may never actually have any symptoms. And if they do, if they are the one of five people who have these symptoms, such as fever, muscle aches, chills, they may not ever know that they have West Nile virus and they may get better on their own.
So not that bad for most of us, but potentially deadly for specific groups.
Now, in some people, especially those who are vulnerable, meaning the elderly, young infants and children, people who may have other underlying chronic illnesses, you can have really deadly, potentially neurological symptoms from West Nile as well, such as meningitis.
And we still don't have any prevention or a specific treatment for West Nile. The Culex mosquito, which carries the virus, likes a wide variety of climates. So it's already been detected in every lower 48 state, with the majority of cases occurring in the central and western parts of the country. But as winters get milder and summers get longer, we're likely to see more cases in traditionally colder states further north. So West Nile is the most deadly mosquito-borne illness in the US, but probably not the creepiest. In 2016, the Rio Olympics highlighted Zika virus with 200,000 cases in Brazil and 5,000 cases in the US that year. And Zika is creepy.
Zika virus freaks me out. Based on what I've seen, Zika can cause these devastating congenital illnesses. So things that babies are born with, such as microcephaly, which literally means small head. and the babies born with microcephaly can have lifelong disabilities.
So Zika is mostly a concern for people who are trying to have a baby or are sexually active with someone who is already pregnant.
Aside from the fact that it can be spread by mosquitoes themselves, it also can be sexually transmitted.
And in recent years, the mosquitoes that carry Zika have been moving north, and models predict the more it warms, the further they'll spread into the north and higher elevations. And these species actually prefer urban areas, often breeding in small man-made containers of stagnant water like discarded tires or buckets. But in the US, there's another insect that poses an even greater threat. Ticks that carry Lyme disease, which can turn into a chronic illness.
Even though cases of Lyme disease tend to be clustered on the East Coast, in the Midwest and the West Coast, we see it everywhere. Even though the CDC reports around 20,000 to 30,000 cases of Lyme disease a year, new estimates suggest that number could be as high as over 400,000, with countless people still having symptoms after they've been given antibiotic treatment.
That's because it can be hard to detect. And the longer it goes untreated, the more likely it becomes a chronic, debilitating illness.
Now, cases of Lyme disease usually present as kind of an ambiguous illness. Usually about 1 to 2 weeks after a tick bite, can present with fever, joint pain, muscle aches. Sometimes we do see this telltale bullseye rash. We call it a target lesion. And if someone doesn't get treatment at this point, Lyme disease can actually turn into a severely debilitating illness that can affect your organs, such as your brain, your heart, and cause arthritis. It can be devastating for people.
And ticks like warm temperatures. So the risk of Lyme disease is highest when they are most active in late spring and early summer months during warm, humid weather. But with winters getting milder and shorter, tick seasons are getting longer. And warmer temperatures also mean they're able to move further north. Over the past few decades, the disease's range has expanded significantly to include most of New England and even parts of Canada. And this trend seems likely to continue. Climate change makes some areas hotter and wetter, benefiting mosquitoes and ticks, but it makes other areas like the US Southwest hotter and drier, benefiting other, maybe creepier pathogens like valley fever. It's a fungus whose spores live in soil. When that soil is disturbed and gets into the air as dust, these spores can be carried with it into our lungs.
While most of the infections are self-limited and goes away, some patients do develop severe infections. This can be a chronic pneumonia that persists for a long time. And sometimes the infection spreads from the lungs to other parts of our body, like our brain, skin, joints, or bones. And that's when it becomes very hard to treat and control.
Thankfully, the number of cases and mortality are still low, but it can be fatal, and it's becoming more common very quickly. Arizona and California have the most cases by far, but it's not just in the Southwest. In recent years, the fungus spread as far north as the state of Washington, and models predict the area where people are exposed to the fungus will double, covering nearly the entire western U.S. by 2095. But the last thing I want to do in this episode is discourage anyone from getting outside and enjoying nature. And even though these threats are very real, there's a lot you can do to avoid getting them. So let's start with mosquitoes. The most effective and easiest measure you can take are simply using the right insect repellent and wearing long sleeve shirts and pants, especially during dusk and dawn when mosquitoes are most active. In terms of repellents, those containing DEET, picaridin, or oil of lemon eucalyptus for those who prefer something more natural are best. And as far as ticks go, the same advice applies regarding those repellents and long sleeves and pants. And after being outdoors, conduct a thorough tick check on yourself and your pets.
Do a full skin exam. This is not just looking at the outside of your arms and your legs, but head to toe, behind your scalp, your ears, your neck, your chest, your torso, you get the point. Everywhere.
And if you do get bitten, the chances of getting Lyme disease go way down if you can remove the tick in the first 24 hours.
And to remove the tick, simple. Get some tweezers, make sure they're sterilized. You want to go as close to the skin as possible, grab the tick and pull it up consistently and firmly. You don't need to twist or jerk it because you may actually worsen the problem. And by the way, those folklore at-home remedies, such as using alcohol or a match to remove the tick, don't do them. They don't work. The tick may actually burrow deeper into your skin, causing more problems. You don't want to do that. All you need is tweezers.
And for valley fever, if you're in a known hotspot, stay indoors during dust storms or when air quality is poor. Wet down construction sites or gardens before digging to minimize dust. Keep windows and doors closed on windy days and use air filtration indoors. And if you do have to go outside in dusty conditions, a trusty N95 goes a long way. Now, let us know, which of these diseases concerns you the most in your region? Share your thoughts or personal stories in the comments below. And be sure to go check out our friends over on PBS Vitals for the latest science on health and the human body. Thanks for watching.